We humans love to imagine a world where everyone has enough of everything and where everyone can be whoever they want. And I really hope that one day we will live in that world. But when thinking about what our perfect world would look like, it is easy to forget that we can't start from scratch. We're here right now in a reality with pretty limited boundaries and limited resources. And if we want to make progress, personally or as a society, we cannot ignore this reality. To illustrate, imagine you're a woman in March 1959 in Switzerland. After decades of fighting for a referendum, two-thirds of Swiss men just rejected your right to vote. Only 12 years later, would you get a say in the design of the society you have to live in? And some cantons would deny you that right for 22 more years. Doesn't that sound silly? In a little more than a decade, one-third of Swiss men changed their vote on something that didn't change at all, a reality that didn't change at all, brains. So if we want to avoid to look stupid to our grandchildren one day, like so many men from 1959 do to us today, we have to become better at making sense of what we do and don't yet know about the world. Because if we don't make an effort of anchoring our society and our beliefs in reality, society is likely to either slowly drift apart or end in tyranny. And part of this effort to anchor our society in reality means finding more effective ways to communicate. I myself have always been fairly good with words. And for a long time, I thought I should become a diplomat or politician. I thought that those who speak confidently often win a lot of influence. And I was fairly convinced of being a good person, which is why it sounded like a win-win for society and for myself. But I slowly realized that many people pay more attention to the aesthetic of an argument than to its content. And I found myself optimizing my own arguments for their aesthetic appeal instead of their truth value. This seems kind of difficult to solve because our brains are really good at making ourselves sound convincing or making someone, usually who agrees with us, sound convincing to our ears. And that's because our brains are pretty lazy. They like to save energy whenever we're basically not chased by a predator. And so that seems problematic because if we don't update our beliefs upon new evidence, unless we're currently being chased by a lion, then what we can talk about is what we believe. And if that is wrong, we talk about weird things. So we should really figure out how to talk in ways that we actually make more sense over time. And if I talk about what I believe, then this means I'm currently sharing something with you that will create common knowledge. And common knowledge is knowledge or information that we all know, and of which we also know that the others know, and that the others know that we know they know too. Basically, think about it like Wikipedia, or parts of it, stored in everyone's brain. And this common knowledge shapes how we perceive reality, what we think is important, or good and bad. Unlike Wikipedia, we don't have editors or explicit guidelines to decide what to keep in, what to throw out, or how to phrase things. So we have to do some of that work ourselves. And that's also why we are likely to do a better job at thinking about common knowledge if we imagine a well. And common knowledge is the groundwater that we get from it. Everyone contributes to it all the time, whether we want to or not. Each one of us, whenever we communicate, influence what is common knowledge and what's not. And we can worry about the 1% of psychopaths who actively try to poison our well, or about technology that has bad impacts. Or we can think about the 99% of people who don't think too much about their output, online or offline. So that's you and me, probably. Because we don't opt into contributing to this well of common knowledge, and we can't opt out, I would like to propose three questions that help us keep our well of common knowledge cleaner, in the same way that we today try to sort our trash, if we are more environmentally conscious. And the first question I'd like to propose is, have I done the work required to have an opinion? The second one is, can I communicate my degree of confidence in a given piece of information? And the third one is, how relevant is this piece of information? Is it relevant enough to become common knowledge? The idea behind the first question, have I done the work required to have an opinion, is that we often share information without any second thought at all. That's because humans evolved to share information to build relationships, not to enrich our well of common knowledge. On Twitter, for example, people share at least twice as many links as anyone is willing to click. And most of this sharing is driven by arousal, as when we enjoy something or something worries us, we tend to want to share it. And so, if our sharing behavior is driven by arousal, often the first thing that gets forgotten is not our reason, it's not our passion, but our reason. And so some of the time that we save today when looking for or receiving information, we have to invest into making sense of information. And there are three quick sanity checks that we can perform that go beyond the obvious fact check. One is a methodology check. There's a bias check and a general understanding check. And I will quickly try to explain them. The methodology check is the idea that we should try to figure out where information comes from and how it was produced. Information based on someone's personal experience is likely to be much less reliable than evidence generated in a double-blind, randomized controlled trial with thousands of people that allows us to single out one key variable and also to filter out the exceptions. The bias check is fairly straightforward. Our brains have evolved to perceive reality in a certain way. And that only gets stronger with the signals we pick up. But sometimes we also wish reality was different, and even that shapes our perception. So, for example, we might have a close one who suffered adverse effects from a vaccination, and then we end up believing that vaccines are bad, even though they save many more lives than they harm. So asking ourselves, might I be engaging in motivated reasoning, can go a long way. And the understanding check, is there such that we can verify whether we have really understood an issue in its entirety? It means asking ourselves whether we can play our own best opponent in a debate. I, for example, used to run around and tell people that genetically engineered crops are really dangerous, because that's what I had heard good arguments for. Until I did some research and realized that there are many arguments for genetically engineered crops, too. So I think performing these three checks would already help us have much more nuanced opinions in our well of common knowledge. And the second question I'd like to propose further helps us to add nuance. And this is whether we can communicate the degree of confidence that we have in a piece of information. All our beliefs can be seen as bets on what reality is like and what is possible in it. And making these bets explicit helps us to gather feedback from the world on how well we're calibrated. So learning how to express these bets is probably very helpful. And that's where confidence levels come in. For example, if I asked you which atoms make up water, most of you would probably be willing to take a bet of 1,000,000 to 1, that it's hydrogen and oxygen atoms. This seems to be a fairly established fact, and you would have a high degree of confidence such that you would bet on it. Of course, many problems are much more complex than which atoms make up water, but we can always find a way to communicate likelihoods with a little bit more nuance. For example, if I want to talk about which threat to humanity currently most urgently needs more people working on, I could either say, I believe that threats from bioengineered pandemics are much worse than climate change, which is easy to disagree with for all kinds of good reasons. Or I could say, given everything I know about climate change, how many people are working on it, and how much money is going into it, I believe that our civilization is less likely to survive extreme climate change than we are to survive a nuclear war, but more likely to survive climate change than we are to survive a bioengineered pandemic, simply because we seem to be less prepared. And sharing my underlying model of the world this way helps us to take apart my belief system instead of headbutting over who's right based on simplistic claims. Communicating with more nuance also allows me to more easily update my own views, as I am not communicating a claim as my belief, but simply as various variables that could change with new evidence. So this might also already help you give, might help me to give you a better sense of what I believe. And this keeps jumping around. Good, we will get there. The third question. Maybe. The third question is about the relevance of the information we share. Is it actually relevant enough? Maybe not. Is it actually relevant enough to be shared? Here again, I would take a bet of 10 to 1 that our drive to connect with other humans via sharing information is much stronger than actually sharing useful or accurate information. So I personally like to ask whether a piece of information is action relevant. Let's think about climate change again and look at the news. People are still talking about the Amazon fires, but we can't do much about them. And in the bigger scheme of things, they're the result of other problems. So what we should probably do is take note, move on, and work on solving the underlying issues. But instead, we often get sidetracked by information that feels relevant, but is not a priority. And sometimes, when we could harm society at large, there even is good reason not to talk about something at all. Think about a scenario where someone publicly denounces one single doctor because they broke their Hippocratic oath. This could lead to an erosion of trust where many other people stop entrusting their doctors with embarrassing health issues and then end up continuing to have them. There's this interesting thing with our brain that once information enters it, it is really hard to get rid of it or not to share it. So we might also want to ask ourselves these questions before we consume information. And often, setting a 5-minute timer is enough to think about the questions. And if it's not worth thinking about them for 5 minutes, it's probably not worth sharing or consuming information with others, especially if it will take them much longer, cumulatively, to process than just your 5 minutes. But if we do take 5 minutes and have a look at the information, then often we will still end up thinking that it is likely to be too difficult for us to really have understood it in depth. And then we need to have good mental habits, good mental hygiene, to deal with this information. And of course, the difficulty is that all of this is kind of futile if we don't have the people around us who do the same. And I think that's where things initially went wrong with the right to vote for women. Most men must have understood that women aren't stupid, but societal incentives held them back. And in society, we celebrate strong opinions, confident speech, and impressive rhetoric. But within our closest circles, we can celebrate when someone updates their opinions, shares their uncertainties, and maybe even flags their possible biases. And even if that is a painful and slow process, I think we can celebrate the reduction of uncertainty a little more. Because, as Voltaire said, doubt is not a pleasant condition, but certainty is an absurd one.
Thank you. Thank you.